Good evening. We're here for a birthday celebration, so come on, you've got to do better than that. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Excellent. I've always wanted to say that. Welcome on behalf of Yorkshire Wildlife Trust to our 70th birthday celebration. It's a sad day yesterday. We just want to mention at the start of today's event about Joe Cox MP, an absolute tragedy. So we just must reflect on that for a moment. We're here for our 70th birthday celebration. We're delighted that we're in this wonderful venue here at the University of York Central Hall. It's fitting in a way because we're very close to where it all started for Yorkshire Wildlife Trust 70 years ago. It's also very fitting because there's quite a lot of staff connections with the University of York as well. And I would like to ask you all to give a warm welcome, please, to Alastair Fitter.
Thank you very much. 70 years ago, almost to the day, not quite, it was actually in May, Francis Terry and Arnold Rowntree, and those are two names that are well entwined with the heritage of York and Yorkshire, donated Ascombe Bog to an organisation that came into being in order to receive it as a gift. That's where it all started. And it's really very fitting indeed that we have representatives of the Terry and Rowntree families in the audience here tonight. Granddaughters, great-grandsons, great-great-nieces are here tonight to help complete that circle. So that's a very nice touch. We are, of course, enormously privileged, delighted, and honoured to have with us this evening a very special guest, who has spent the afternoon at our birthplace at Ascombe Bog. It's about the only piece of superb natural habitat in the world he's never visited, I think, before. So it's rather nice that he was there. And I think I can genuinely, for the first time in my life, say tonight's speaker needs no introduction.
Thank you very much for inviting me to join your birthday party. 70 years is a very important time for any of us. Some of us exceed it, of course, and have a little bigger birthday party, but it's a pretty good birthday party for 70 years. The Yorkshire Trust is legendary in nature conservation in this country. You were the second trust. The first was the Norfolk Trust. The Norfolk Trust was helped enormously by the Cadbury family. You, the Yorkshire Trust, came second in 1946. And there the Terry family and the other family from the chocolate dynasties were joining here, and were great support to this trust. In those days, the trusts, I think, in Britain, were considered to be kind of specialist things, people who didn't know about them. They thought they were about butterfly collecting, which you could do in those days, or they were about ticking off how many birds you've seen. They were specialist things. They weren't something that the general public was particularly interested in. Might be perfectly inoffensive, but not perhaps for them. And maybe there was just something in the truth in that. But if that was the case, it didn't last long. The trust, this trust, Yorkshire Trust, started off to show people that the natural world isn't just for the specialist. The natural world has fascination for people of all kinds and all ages. It isn't just that you recognize a bird song. It isn't just that you want to find a rare butterfly. Trusts and visits to trusts and association and understanding of the natural world is a very important element in all our lives. And if we get divorced from the natural world, we lose something of profound importance. I make natural history programs and I get a lot of correspondence from people about their reactions to seeing the natural world on television. And of course they're interested in the beauty, of course they're interested in the drama, of course they're interested in seeing wonderful, extraordinary things. And I get correspondence. And this is literally true. I can open a letter from a boy of 7 asking me a question about something I saw, and the very next letter can be a letter from a zoology professor who saw something in the programs which he didn't quite understand and asks me a technical question. So the natural world appeals across a whole range of people. But also amongst those letters, there will be letters from people who have some personal tragedy and who say, watching the natural world, understanding the natural world, feeling a part of the natural world, has given me support and given me solace. So the natural world is an important element in all our lives. But I put it to you that it is probably more important now than it has ever been. The United Nations now have explained and have stated that over 50% of the people living in the world today are urbanized. That's to say, most people today are to some degree cut off from the natural world. So they have lost something. Is it important? Is it just a question of pleasure? Is it just a question of delight in seeing a peacock butterfly? Or hearing a bird that you've never heard sing before? I put it to you that it is more profound than that. And that it is more important than that. We depend upon the natural world. We depend on the natural world for every breath we breathe and for every mouthful we eat. We are part of the natural world. If we don't understand the natural world and don't have a feeling for the natural world, then we are to some degree in danger. Because the natural world today is in greater danger than it has ever been. And that applies on the whole range and the whole scale of things. It applies globally, don't we know? It applies, but it also applies on our own doorstep. It is an extraordinary thing, isn't it, that in my lifetime, there were cities on the coasts of this country who thought it was perfectly acceptable to pour raw sewage into the sea because the sea was infinitely big. And now There is no place in the oceans of the world where you can go where you can find untainted water. Now, what we have put into the atmosphere has caused the temperature of the sea to rise. Not only that, but it has become more acidic. Global changes from what we have done to the environment. Now, unless we understand the importance of these things and what causes these things, then the human race is in great danger. And that is why, bringing the argument round in a circle, the way we look after the natural world on our own doorsteps, the way we cherish it, the way we look after it, and the way we can understand from it the way in which these processes control the natural world. Unless we understand that, we're in trouble. And we have to understand it because we then have to give support to organizations that are going to spend your money on taking conservation issues seriously. So, conservation, there could not be a more important subject on the international scale. But where does it come from? It comes from your doorstep. This is where it begins. This is where you will find that contact with the natural world, which I've been speaking of, is in the palm of your hand and in the sights of your eyes. If we lose that, we have lost the most important and most valuable treasure that we possess. And Yorkshire was the first, among the first, it was actually the second organisation in this country which put it to the local population to support. And now this organisation is legendary in the conservation movement. And now people worldwide, nationwide, look to the Yorkshire Trust for leadership, for what it's been doing. And your support and your success could not be more important internationally. So on your 70th birthday, I congratulate you for all the support you've given. And I urge you to go on to greater things, because of all the social organizations of which I'm aware, I think none is more important to you, to the nation, and to the young people of this country than those who are looking after our natural heritage. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sir David Attenborough. We've now got our question and answer session, so thank you to all of you who've submitted questions. We've had one or two, as you might imagine. So we're going to do our best to get through as many as we can. Sir David has given us a huge amount of his time today, but has a train to catch, so we will do our best. So I would now like to invite to the stage Yorkshire Wildlife Trust's president, Sir John Lawton.
So good evening, everybody. Is this on? Great. It was deafening back there, was that applause? It was just great. We've tried to group the questions. We had over 220, so we've grouped the questions because quite a lot of them were the same. I'm going to read out the question and the person who asked it, and then ask David to comment or come back, and we may get into a dialogue. So the first one comes from Louise Wilkinson, and she says, David, you've come close to many potentially dangerous animals and filmed in some pretty challenging locations. Have you had any very close shaves?
Well,
that's 5 minutes.
The most dangerous animal by far that I've ever encountered is a man who doesn't speak your language, who's had perhaps rather too much to drink, who doesn't necessarily like the look of your face, and has an armed gun, and that has a particular poignancy today, up here. Apart from such dreadful things. Yes, of course, but by and large, you know, animals don't want to attack you. By and large, it's not economic in terms of energy and danger and one thing or another for an animal to attack you. It would much rather leave you alone. So it will give you a false warning, he'll give you a false charge or a warning of some kind. And if you've got any sense and if you've got any experience of the natural world, you know that the moment has come to back off. So in a sense, when I say I haven't really had a lot of dangerous experiences, I'm boasting because I'm saying, you know, I'm so clever that I didn't get into danger. It's another way of saying I'm on the nervous side and a bit on the cowardly side. But anyway, the answer is no. But on occasion, in spite of the best of things, it does sometimes happen. I was once asked to go and film some elephants, and the producer said, there's a herd that we're going to investigate, and we're going to go on one side with a camera car, and then you'll go on the other side in another Land Rover, and then I want you to walk towards the queue, the camera, and the elephants. And I said, that's not a good idea. elephants, you know, charge, and they drive you into the ground like a tent peg. And he said, no, we have got the world's greatest expert on elephants who will guide you. So I said, thank you, well, fine. So his name was Jonathan, do you know him?
Yeah.
Jonathan? Yes.
Yes, sir.
And
he's still alive.
Yeah. And so we came to his elephants, and he said, I know them all. They're all fine. So we could just see over the backs of the elephants, the camera car with a tripod on the top. And we got out of the car, and he had one of his wife's stockings with some talcum powder in it, and he was doing this all the time. And as long as the talcum powder was coming towards you, you knew that's where the wind was coming, so the elephants couldn't smell you, so he was fine. And he was saying things like, oh, that's Queen Victoria. I know her awfully well. She remember since she was a calf and this sort of thing. And I was terrified of the whole deal. And the camera was doing all this. And eventually we got a thumbs up sign from the camera on the other side of the group, and meaning it was okay. And I was off like a rabbit, I don't mind telling you. And when I got back in the Land Rover, this Jonathan turned up and sitting there and unperturbed, but I was, of course, very, very nervous. And he said, do you enjoy that? And I said, oh, yeah, okay, thank you very much. And we drove off, and we hadn't gone more than about a couple of hundred yards when he suddenly said, did you hear that? And I said, what? He said, well, we were charged by a rhino. I said, were we? He said, oh, yes, but you know, it's a dummy charge. That's what they do. The rhinos, like elephants, they just warn you when they're going to charge. So they charged, but he wouldn't have stopped. I said, oh. So he said, we drove on, and then suddenly there was a, in the distance, and another thing. And out of this bush came a rhinoceros at about 45 to 50 miles an hour. And it hit the back of the Land Rover, and put its horn underneath the back of it, lifted up the Land Rover bodily, so the wheels, back wheels were off the ground, and shook it. And I could see Jonathan's hands on the steering wheel, white knuckles. And I said, God, that was a hell of a dummy charge, wasn't it? And before I knew what had happened, the rhino reappeared and did it again. And it actually ripped up the tyres on both rear wheels, and we had to sit there waiting, knowing that the rhinoceros was waiting too, until someone came out to look for us. And so, have I been in dangerous circumstances? Well, I would have been if I had been silly enough to get out of the car with a rhinoceros, but which I wasn't, so I just sat there and felt humiliated.
Very good, very good. Now, the next question is related. You've maybe already answered it, David. Let's see. It's from two of our younger members, Aoife and Sinead Camlin, from Poppleton Oosebank Primary School. Are you here? There they are. Great, we're doing your question. And it was, when thinking about your career, what was your most memorable wildlife experience? Not the most terrifying, the most memorable.
I think one which is easily available to every single one of you, if you're lucky enough. I mean, it's not dependent upon skill or upon knowledge particularly, but it is extraordinary revelation. And that is the first moment in which you dive on a barrier, on a coral reef, if you're even remotely competent as an underwater swimmer. You see 100 different creatures you've never seen before in your life, all of them amazingly beautiful, things you didn't believe existed or could have existed of such astonishing shape and beauty, and it becomes just the most memorable moment in your career. It may not be the romantic or the most exciting one, but that is certainly the one that I look back on as the moment that was a real revelation, that was almost life-changing. Underwater swimming on a coral reef. Otherwise, there is a moment which I am being reminded all the time on the television, which is the moment I sat with gorillas. And that, again, was a huge privilege. And it only happened because of an extraordinary woman called Diane Fossey, who habituated gorillas to her presence. And had it not been for her, we couldn't have got anywhere near those wonderful mountain gorillas in Rwanda. And the reason we wanted to do it was because it was a series called Life on Earth, and it was tracing the history of life. The moment when the thumb and forefinger met together like that was a very important moment in the history of life, because it meant that you could grasp things. Now, monkeys and apes use that opposable thumb, as it's called. They use that for swimming around in a tree, hanging onto branches. But human beings also have this, and they could use it not just for branches, but for holding tools. So it's a climacteric moment in the history of humanity. And that was why I was going to demonstrate it with gorillas. And the idea was that they would be over there sitting around eating and showing the opposable thumb, and I would be sitting at a safe distance closer to the camera. And we saw them sitting at a distance, and the director said, go and sit alongside them, see? So I crawled along to what I thought was a safe distance for them sitting behind me. And while I was just about to turn to the camera, I suddenly felt a hand come on my head. And it twisted my head round, and this was an enormous female gorilla. And she put a finger in my mouth, opened the mouth, and looked inside. And I sat there, and I was truly in a kind of delirium. It was like paradise. And then I thought, this isn't the moment to talk about the opposable thumb. And while I was doing that, I felt a weight on my feet, and her two babies came and were undoing my shoelaces. And I just sat there, blissful. And then they babies ambled away, and she got up, heaved off, went off. And I called back to the camera crew, and I said to the director, "Wasn't that unbelievable?" And he said, "I think we've got a few seconds of it." And I said, "I said a few seconds. I was there for about 10 minutes." And he said, "Yes, I know, but I was waiting for you to talk about the opposable and we only had a little bit of film left in the camera, and I thought we were going to run out."
Okay.
Well, so that was my second unheard memorable moment.
Right. Well, the next question is a sort of logically follows from that, and that's from another young man called Zach. Is Zach in the audience? Where's Zach? Oh, hi, Zach. Wait. Right, Zach asked you, David, apart from the fact that the best way to get interested, young people interested in wildlife is to listen to you, what do you think the other best way of getting young people interested in wildlife is?
My experience is that just simply putting wildlife in front of them. It seems to me that even, I mean, I was talking about going to the Barrier Reef and looking at things, but you don't have to go to the Barrier Reef to find extraordinary, amazing, weird, mind-blowing creatures. You can get a little net and you can put it in a pond. And I dare say a lot of expert biologists here will know everything that you can get out of a pond, but there may be one or two things that you don't know, and they will be certainly things that a young person may not have seen. And so just getting in touch with wildlife is very, very important. And every child, I believe, has that capacity to do it. And it's up to the responsibility of those of us who are adults to make sure that children get that chance.
There you are. There's your answer. So, again, just picking up another of those themes, David, what, from Nicholas Shepherd, who asks you, what were those early days of filming like compared to now, given the resources and technology that are now available?
Well, they were very, very different. I started, the first trip I went on was 1954, and the only camera we had was a clockwork camera that you wound it up. It ran for 20 seconds. Then you had to stop it and wind it up again. And after you had taken 10 minutes worth of those short bursts, you had to take the side off the camera and take out the film. And then if you're in the tropics or something, it's very easily ruined by humidity and so on. So we would put it in a biscuit tin and seal it round with some silica gel in the middle to keep it dry. And then maybe, because you were away in West Africa in 1954, communications weren't so good, it could be 2 months before you even saw it. So I'm not the cameraman, I was with the cameraman, and I had no idea what we had. And on one occasion, actually in Paraguay, about the late 60s, early 60s, we had a whole cans for biscuit tins full, which we sent back, and we sent it back by air, and we got a telegram, which is what we had in those days, which said, "Regret to say your 150mm lens," that was the lens which gave you all the close-ups, "has a hot spot in the middle." That means so it was burnt out. So it was all unusable. All the close-ups you had were unusable, and we had worked for 2 months with that. So in those days, it was tough. And not only that, but also there was no way in which you could synchronize sound with picture, so you couldn't talk to camera either. Well, they were interesting days. We did some nice things. But compared with now there is nothing in the world that we can't film. We can film at night, we can film during the day, We can film small things, we can film enormous things. We can put film on little on drones which fly around and you can guide independently. We can slow things up, we can slow things down, we can speed things up. We can go under the water, we can go to the top of Everest, we can go anywhere. And in a way, it's almost embarrassing, this great ability we now have. But we can see things that no human being ever seen before in before our generation. Nobody had seen the bottom of the abyssal sea 50 years ago, 70 years ago. And so we have visions of the world which are unparalleled. But don't bother about those complex things. People write a lot to me and say, I would like to make natural history programs. And what is your advice? And my advice is simple. Get a little bit of simple home video, which is, it costs money, but it doesn't cost an exorbitant amount of money. And try and make a film about something common. It could be a pigeon. It could be a mouse. It could be a slug. Anything. And see whether you really want to spend your time lying on your stomach waiting for something to happen. And see whether, in fact, you have an ability to put pictures together to tell a story. And if you do, you will discover whether you really want to take that as a career. But also, you may have something which you could go to a prospective employer and say, look, I'm not just thinking about this. I do seriously want to make natural history films. And this is what I can do without any help, but now can you give me help to do something better? So that is what my advice would be.
Thank you, David. Now, David, you started your distinguished career with ZooQuest, and zoos have a bit of an ambiguous press at the moment, and Holly Little asks, I'm currently working as a research intern at a zoo. How important do you now think the work of zoos to do, the work that zoos do for education and conservation, how important is the work that zoos currently do for conservation and education?
Well, zoos can do things that nobody else can do. They can conduct scientific studies and so on upon the animals that they hold, which would be very difficult to do in any other way, and which can teach us very valuable things about animals. Zoos can also bring you, whatever your age, into the presence of other animals, so that if you go, you don't really understand the reality of an elephant until you've actually been to a zoo and seen it sort of creaking in its skin and the smell of it and the size of it and so on. That's very important too. Zoos can also tell us a lot about captive breeding, to take species which may be in danger and reintroduce them. Though I have to say that 50 years ago we thought that was a solution to a lot of problems of conservation. We now know that it's much, much more difficult than we supposed, because reintroductions of species that have disappeared from the wild cause all kinds of problems and are very difficult to be sure that you'll get success, partly because the environment may well have changed since those animals left it, partly because the reason why they became so rare as to be on the verge of extinction in the wild may not have changed, and there were just the same things there. And partly because there's something about captive bred animals which make it difficult for them to understand and survive in the wild. It depends on what kind of animal we're talking about. If we're talking about an insect, that's one thing. If we're talking about an ape, that's quite another. So there are very great difficulties involved in that. Nonetheless, reintroductions have worked and have said there wouldn't be Arabian oryx now if it wasn't for zoos. There wouldn't be Per David's deer now if there wasn't for zoos. There wouldn't be Hawaiian geese now if it wasn't for zoos. But all those things rest on the one proposition, is that zoos must look after the animals in the very best possible way. There's a lot of science now about keeping animals, and zoos have to take notice of that. But providing that do, then those other circumstances, I think, those other causes or those other justifications are valid.
Thank you, David. So one of the things that I learned today is that David had never actually been to Askham Bog. Shame.
Before.
But he's now been to Askham Bog. And one of the questions from Karen Forhey was, when looking at the list, the long list of places that you've been, there must be some few places in the world that you haven't visited. Which of those would you most like to go to?
Which place I'd like to go?
Most that you've never been to in the world.
I would quite like to go to the centre of the Gobi Desert. I don't think I'm likely to go there because I'm sent to make films about animals and there are hardly any animals in the Gobi Desert. But I've never been there, and there are very interesting people who live in the Gobi Desert, but they're also dinosaur fossils, you know. And I find fossils very romantic, and the dinosaurs, fossils, are the most romantic of the lot. So I wouldn't mind going there if you can arrange it for me.
We could all chip in a fiver, couldn't we? Send you steerage. Okay, well, you see, that's a very nice lead-in to a question from Holly Schofield, who said, if you had the ability to bring back one extinct plant or animal, what would it be and why?
Well, bearing in mind what I just said, I would like to bring back a creature called Quetzalcoatlus. And Quetzalcoatlus is a pterosaur. The popular name, they used to call them pterodactyls, but pterodactyls is just one of a group of flying reptiles called pterosaurs. And Quetzalcoatlus was the biggest of the lot. It was the size of a small aeroplane. And we appear on television or indeed in university lecture theatres and explain how it was that they got into the air. I simply don't believe a lot of the explanations which I'm told, because it is a heck of a problem as to how you're going to get in the air with a wingspan of that size. There are sufficient muscles or signs of muscles on the breast of the pterosaurs to show that they could flap to a degree. But if you've got wings that are 10, 12 metres across, how do you flap? How do you get enough speed to get into the air? So I'd like to see how they managed that. Did they live on cliffs? And if they did, what happened if they never made it back home?
That's why they're extinct.
Yeah. The other thing that I'd like to know about Quetzalcoatlus is they have very long necks and quite extraordinary vertebrae in the necks, in that the vertebrae lock together. They fit together like that so that you get a rigid pole. And I have a theory as to what the function of that pole was. It's only my theory, and I don't know anybody else who either thinks about it or believe it. But what I think is that if you watch vultures, for example, attack a carcass of a big animal in the African plains, what they do is to rip open the abdomen and then they stick their heads inside and pull out the guts. And I think that if you're a brontosaurus, or one of these enormous great things, sort of 100 feet long, you have an enormous belly. And to get inside that and pull out the guts, you need a leg as long as a giraffe's and as stiff as a pole. And that would go in. And I'd like to see that was true.
Picture. Okay. Great stuff. Now, slightly more up-to-date question, but bringing back species, Jacqueline Simpson asks, What are your thoughts on striving to retain or reintroduce declining or extinct species in Britain or indeed anywhere else, sometimes at very great cost?
What they call rewilding.
Rewilding.
Well, it has happened. We've done it, of course. We've done it with the sea eagle, very successfully in Scotland, a magnificent bird that we lost in this country and which is reintroduced. We've done it with the red kite, which is now a common bird in between Oxford and London, where I travel a long road. I should be very surprised if I don't see one or two on that sort of trip. So it has been done. I think the only the word of caution that you have to say is each species has to be considered on its own base, on its own merits and demerits. Where are you going to do it? One of the views at the moment is that we should reintroduce wolves. The argument being that unless you reintroduce wolves, the red deer population of this country will, if you don't shoot it, will increase beyond proportion. So you'll be driven to shooting red deer, which of course we do. There are deer stalkers and who keep that, and keepers who keep deer population down by shooting. I live very near Richmond Park. There's a very big population of red deer there, and at certain times of the year, I can hear the noise of rifles in the middle of the night while red deer are being culled. And that's the reality. But whether the solution is that we should introduce wolves into Richmond Park is a very, very different thing. But there are people who think that wolves should be introduced into north of Scotland. And that may be all right if you've got a vast area with very few people in it. But I think I would be a bit cautious about introducing wolves in the north of Scotland, or indeed anywhere else. And so some are okay, some are questionable, and in the middle there are some debatable ones. There is beavers in the southwest of this country, which people are thinking of introducing. The objectors say that the beavers fell a lot of trees and build dams and fill more trees than they really need. There are those then who tell us that in fact the species of beaver they were going to introduce is not the one that they're talking about in North America, but is a different beaver which has different habits. Sure. Whether that's true or not, I don't. I mean, I know it's a different beaver, but do they have different habits?
They don't build as big a dam. Ours don't build as big a dam as a North American.
As big a dam.
But they build nonetheless. They build teeny, teeny little dams.
Well, okay.
So no, I'm sorry.
That's the one where I plead ignorance and I don't know. What I do know is that the first thing we have to do is to care for what we've got, and we're not doing so brilliantly on that. When the second thing is that each one has to be examined on its own merits and its own circumstances.
Very good. So what I'm going to do now, because we have to keep an eye on the time, there are two questions that were asked that strike me as being intimately linked. So I'm going to combine, bring them together. So Jeff David asked, how do you think the wildlife scene will have changed in a further 70 years from now? Very interesting question. Because that depends on a second question from Peter Batchel that said, how can we get politicians to take a more interest in wildlife and the environment? They're linked.
How we proceed now? Well, we have to see our countryside not just as a few hot spots with walls around them. The concept of a sanctuary in which things were kept safe and people were kept out is an old-fashioned concept by a long way. People and wildlife can live closely together. In harmony if the people concerned understand enough about wildlife and care to look after wildlife. So the notion that wildlife reserves and you create them and that's all there is to it is, in my view, an outdated one, because the natural world exists in our gardens. Any of us who've got a garden can help with wildlife. Any of us can do something to enable wild number of different and different species of birds to come to us by providing them with the right sort of food. And so living in harmony with the wildlife, not just in the reserves, which always will be very important, but in the wider countryside, is the way that we have to go. But having said that, the short answer is join the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust.
Just to push the little point about raising the profile of nature conservation up the political agenda, of course, membership of the Trust also... There are more members of the Wildlife Trusts or the RSPB than the entire political parties of the country. There's a really interesting statistic I saw the other day that says that there are more people put a pair of binoculars around their neck and go out into the countryside deliberately to look at nature, not just birds, than go to Premier League football matches.
Really?
You just don't see them all in one place. And they don't get paid as much. So, I mean, do you have any thoughts, David, about... I mean, there are politicians who care, there are some good politicians, we've both met them. But, you know, in general, at the moment, the debate that we're having politically, and I don't want to go into that, but it's a classic example of the kind of debates we have, the environment virtually doesn't figure at all. It's jobs and so on. I mean, do you have a silver bullet for how we get politicians to take what we believe in so passionately, seriously?
Well, I don't think we should be too depressed about it, because I do think that the situation has changed very, very considerably over the last 70 years that this trust has been in existence. I think the politicians now actually care what you say.
Yeah, they do.
And the more vociferous you are, and the greater numbers of them of you that there are, the more they will take notice. In my view, the trusts as a whole have united in these last 70 years to become a united voice, which actually politicians do take seriously. I mean, there have been changes in the legislation concerning reserves, but also particularly with coastal reserves and sea reserves, which we didn't think about only 20 years ago. And of course, politicians are under pressure all the time from specialist pressure groups. Okay, well, if that's the case, then we are a pressure group. And the Wildlife Trusts, speaking with a united voice of all 47 of the trusts, can be a very powerful political pressure group, and so we ought to be.
And on that rousing note, I'm going to draw this to a close. Thank you very much for your questions. Say a lot of them overlap, so I hope David was able to comment on, if you did put a question in, something that was closely related, if not identical, to the question you asked. And it just really serves for me to say to David, thank you for a marvellous day. I've thoroughly enjoyed it. I hope you have. Thank you for coming to Yorkshire. And it never rains in Yorkshire, you know.
Thank you very much.
Could I just ask you to show your appreciation for Sir John Lawton? Right, okay, just a few little formalities. You will have all found a little envelope on your chair, I hope, and I hope it's now full of money and has your name and address written on the back. We've had some wonderful prizes donated to us, so all the money that we're going to raise, hopefully this evening, will go towards our Potterick Carr Visitor Centre appeal, I'm pleased to say. So We're a charity, please give generously. And then on your way out this evening, look out for the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust staff in the black shirts. They'll all have buckets and you can just chuck them in there on the way out. We're going to draw the prizes on Monday and we will let the lucky winners know if they've been successful. We'll also put it up on the website and in the magazine in September. One thing, if you'd like to watch this again, the fantastic AV team here at University of York have been filming this. I've been sitting there backstage watching, so it's been fantastic for us two to see. And it will be, it's been streamed live onto YouTube, so hopefully there's people all around the world watching this as well as you guys, hopefully including my daughter Adelaide and son Solomon with a bit of luck. Hello. We will go back and get it edited nicely and then we'll release it later next week, so you'll get the chance to watch again if you want to do that. So anyway, I'd now like to introduce a short film that was made by the Wildlife Trust to celebrate the centenary of the Wildlife Trust, which was a couple of years ago. So sit back, relax and enjoy the film.
Imagine a landscape where wildlife can share our world, where the sights and sounds of nature are part of everyday life. The vision for living seas and living landscapes drives today's Wildlife Trust movement. But for a century, it has championed nature. From early pioneers to latter-day conservationists, the Wildlife Trusts have inspired millions to know and love the living world.
I think the trusts are in better heart than they have ever been in my experience. There are more people there, they're better organised, they're more effective, they have a louder voice in Parliament and in governmental things. I think the trusts are in very good heart, which is as well, because the dangers are greater than ever.
In the early 20th century, land management was changing fast. Urban development and advances in agriculture were starting to put pressure on the natural world. A young Charles Rothschild, naturalist and banker, watched the marshes and fens of eastern England change beyond measure. One of the last fragments, Wood Walton Fen, was at risk.
I think Rothschild recognised that some places simply needed to be preserved because, and as it were, taken out of development, that we were to see them as something precious in their own right.
Rothschild knew that losses were occurring at a rapid pace. He saved Wood Walton from being drained for agriculture, but Rothschild's wider vision to protect Britain's natural habitats marks the beginning of nature conservation as we know it today.
This is the boardroom of the Natural History Museum. And it was here in May 1912 that the first ever meeting of the Society for the Promotion of Nature Reserves was held. Charles Rothschild would have been in the chair and he had his colleagues around him. Most of them scientists, naturalists. And this is where it all began.
Rothschild's new Society for the Promotion of Nature Reserves adopted a vigorous approach to conservation.
Rothschild had a lot of influential friends. He knew a lot of landowners. He's from the wealthy aristocracy. And he set about, as it were, surveying the British Isles and looking at places that he felt were uniquely worthy of preservation. And if we look at his map of 284 sites, I think it was now, it's astonishing to see the sophistication of his vision. He knew just which bits we needed. We needed representations of lowland heath and raised peat bogs, of ancient woodland, of Caledonian pine forest, of marshes, and so on. It was extraordinary. I mean, many of the places which he selects are nature reserves now.
government had not yet accepted the need for nature conservation. But others had begun to share Rothschild's vision. In 1926, part of the North Norfolk coast came up for sale, and the Norfolk Naturalists Trust was formed.
And it was founded with the purpose of protecting, preserving, in Rothschild's sense, the Clye marshes, which were threatened with other kinds of development. And a wide group got together and said, no, this is very special, this place. We must keep it. And looking back, that probably has the flavour of the first wildlife trusts as we know them today.
What did the Second World War bring for nature conservation? Surprisingly, as early as 1940, the government was already planning for a better, brighter post-war Britain. The Society for the Promotion of Nature Reserves would play a crucial role.
There was a move to consider nature conservation, and there were these two or three classic meetings in the Moses Room in the House of Lords. And I really think that's quite remarkable that at a time when the war was going pretty badly for the Allies, nevertheless, they began to plan for a conservation strategy in Britain.
The Moses Room meetings led to a series of forceful reports on nature conservation in Britain. Coordinated by the SPNR, regional committees gathered lists of proposed statutory nature reserves. Government action was needed. Wildlife was facing increasing pressure.
At the end of the war, the British countryside changed in a revolutionary and radical way. The pattern of the landscape of the 30s, of little patchwork fields with hedges around them and so on, that had to disappear and did disappear during the war when growing food for ourselves was of national importance.
Despite these changes, a conservation strategy for Britain was in place. Government would establish national nature reserves, sites of special scientific interest, and the National Parks and Access to the Countryside Act became law in 1949. But an act alone was not enough. Local action was urgently needed.
The Lincolnshire Trust already manages about 2,000 acres and more than 20 reserves. Ted Smith.
Arthur Edward Smith, known as Ted Smith, filmed here in 1967, was a post-war pioneer of nature conservation. He helped found the Lincolnshire Trust in 1948 and was to play an important role in the SPNR's future too. Now in his 90s, no trust could have had a more dedicated champion than Ted Smith. But he was also to play a crucial role in the development of the trust movement as a whole.
There were half a dozen of us by the middle 50s, half a dozen trusts, and we got together and decided that we wanted some kind of national body. We wanted our independence. It's important to keep local autonomy. This is a movement very much motivated and run by local people. But we needed a body which would help, which would advise, which would look for funding from national sources, which would represent our views and speak for us at national level and so on. And so we went to the SPNR and said, you know, can we come in?
The Wildlife Trusts movement was underway and staged its first national conference in 1960.
So the Trusts organised a conference. Lincolnshire hosted it at Skegness and at Gibraltar Point. I didn't realise it was going to make headlines, but that was just a statement of what the Trust wanted from a national body. And the movement suddenly snowballed. I mean, within 3 years, there were 36 trusts. Within a few more years, the whole country was covered.
This explosion in trust membership meant that the message of nature conservation was reaching a wider public. Never was their support more needed. Trusts enlisted the support of local people to rescue meadows and moorland, wetland and woodland across the UK. A local fundraising campaign meant that the Berkshire, Buckinghamshire and Oxfordshire Trust could acquire Warburg Nature Reserve in 1968 to preserve its ancient woodland and chalk grassland. Newly acquired reserves offered the chance to improve habitats and study wildlife in greater detail. The Society worked closely with the local trusts to coordinate campaigns, improve legal protection for wildlife, and ban pesticides. A name change to the Royal Society for Nature Conservation also brought each trust a seat on the board. And the movement was about to expand further. The mission to engage children with nature has been one of the defining aims of the Wildlife Trust movement.
Watch is the Society's club for young people. Watch involves its young members in caring for wildlife and the environment. The club magazine, Watch Word, is packed full of ideas.
Kids at that age are little sponges for information, and you can catch their interest so easily.
Does anyone know? Can anyone guess, maybe, how many different species of tree there are in the world?
In other words, we were injecting... What I was saying, the business of understanding leads to concern and then to love, which is what it's all about.
Meanwhile, new groups were springing up to protect urban wildlife and provide an opportunity for people to connect to nature near their homes and workplaces. The Urban Wildlife Group began in Birmingham in 1981. And soon trusts were formed in Avon, Cleveland, Sheffield, and London. Armies of keen young volunteers energized the movement with their desire to create and maintain a healthy environment. And they were prepared to fight for it. The Wildlife Trust's work was boosted in the 90s by new heritage lottery funding, bringing on board more staff and allowing new reserves and visitor centres to be acquired. The Otters and Rivers project was a large-scale example of trusts working with landowners to manage habitats, in this case for the otter and other wetland wildlife. The new-look Badger logo also heralded a name change to the Wildlife Trusts. Attention also began to turn to the marine environment. The Trusts lobbied MPs, and the Petition Fish campaign also played a part in getting a Marine Act passed in 2009. The Trust movement was fast becoming a leading force in marine conservation. And now the Living Seas campaign reminds us that we have, for too long, assumed the abundance of our oceans was limitless. The marine ecosystem is vulnerable and needs time to recover.
Protecting the sea's wildlife is incredibly urgent. We really have got to get it right in the next 10 years. We just owe it to future generations. Now we've realised and recognised the full extent of the problem, that we've got to turn it round and put it very quickly, much quicker than we have on land. We have to turn that problem round.
Yorkshire Wildlife Trust are monitoring seabird numbers on their reserve at Flamborough Head and surveying parts of the North Sea to ensure the right marine protected areas can be in place. Cornwall Wildlife Trust are also playing a leading part in the Living Seas campaign. These volunteer divers are being taken on a dive in the Fal Estuary to search for seaweeds which inhabit inshore waters. The divers spend an hour underwater. What they can identify today will help others protect for tomorrow. For the Wildlife Trusts, recovery of the seas goes hand in hand with recovery of the landscape. In 2006, the Wildlife Trusts published A Living Landscape, a report which captured the movement's ambition for nature's recovery. It's a new era for nature conservation, Urgent action now will secure a better long-term future for wildlife and people. It means managing land beyond refuge nature reserves, so wildlife can extend its range and more easily adapt to the challenge of climate change. Lobbying by the trusts led to the government commissioning a major report, Making Space for Nature, in 2010. John Lawton chaired the panel.
On this site, Askham Bog, we're seeing what nature conservation has been, which is to take an existing site that is extremely important for nature, at putting a fence around it, basically, and looking after it. But we know that that strategy hasn't worked to the extent it should have worked, because we're still losing species, plants and animals at a really quite alarming rate across the English countryside. So the thing that we need is a step change, a major step change, so that we begin to restore nature.
And what we want to do now is to have the government recognise that society needs nature to be put back where we've lost it. We want to effectively have the 1949 Act, but for nature's recovery. And that's where I think the trusts are at. We're saying, are we going to sit around on the goal line and defend the lead we've secured over the last 9900 years? Or are we going to go out there now, as Rothschild and Ted Smith and Herbert Smith would have wanted us to do, and say it's not good enough, actually. We need to put nature back in its rightful place. And our belief is, if we can inspire enough people with the vision of a living landscape, then it will be obvious that we must protect what we've currently got.
The Wildlife Trusts are enjoying one of the most exciting periods in their history, with trusts across the UK, the Isle of Man and Alderney. But Simon King believes there is still work to be done.
I think one of the greatest dangers that face the natural world in the British Isles is apathy. And whilst I am very lucky to be president at a time when there are lots of positive initiatives, when the trusts right around Britain are driving forward with all of this fabulous energy and positive rhetoric, there is a danger in people generally thinking that someone else is doing it. They're not. And so, no, we can't sit back on any laurels. We all have to get up. We have to lend our voice to the natural world, and we have to get behind it so that we ultimately are the beneficiaries.
Hello again. Is this on? Yeah, hello again.
I need to... So what I'm going to do for the next 20 minutes or so is expand a little bit on the history of the Wildlife Trust movement that you've already heard about, but I'm going to tailor it very much to the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust as part of that wider trust movement, because we haven't heard very much about the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust in this. Old David was fulsome in his praise of what we're doing. By the way, it occurs to me that I may be the only speaker in the world who had David Attenborough as a warm-up act. You've heard about Charles Rothschild. Nature conservation, in the sense that we understand it, was down to that remarkable man. He was exceedingly wealthy, part of the Rothschild banking family. But actually, what nobody's told you today, he was an entomologist. He studied insects. And he was a world expert on fleas. He discovered a lot of species. He was an extremely good naturalist and also, as I said, extremely wealthy. And in May, as you heard, he convened a meeting at the British Museum of Natural History with just three friends to speak of a vision for nature conservation. His genius was to realise that not only did individual species need protection, there were species protection societies, including at that time the nascent RSPB, and laws to protect things like seabirds, but Rothschild realised that the real problem lay in the destruction of habitats, and it was habitats that needed protecting.
And so an article appeared in the Times, a leader appeared in the Times in December 1912. It is widely reported that actually Rothschild wrote it for the editor and then gave it to him and said, print that. There is a need to preserve the tracts and nooks of land that represent the last relics of unspoiled nature, replete with their old native flora and fauna. And he envisaged, there's a mistake on this slide. To my horror, I discovered this morning when I was looking through the talk. He envisaged Wood Walton Fen, not Wicken Fen, to be a prototype nature reserve, because he owned the entire chunk of Wood Walton Fen. And he intended to give it to the nation as the first prototype nature reserve. I feel doubly ashamed because that is actually a picture of Wood Walton Fen and a picture of the windmill at Wood Walton Fen that I took in 1962. The outcome of that important meeting was the establishment of the Society for the Promotion of Nature Reserves, whose aims were, as you have heard again, to identify the best places for wildlife in Britain and Ireland and to promote their protection by lobbying and persuasion, not by ownership. And that actually was the deep flaw in their vision. It was by lobbying and persuasion, somebody else would own them, that was the flaw in Rothschild's vision. They would actually be owned by, he thought, the National Trust. And in those days, the actual early charter of the National Trust, as well as houses and buildings and great gardens, the original charter of the National Trust also recognised the wild heritage of the British Isles as part of its proper responsibilities. And indeed, in terms of landscape, that was true. The National Trust now owns, as you're aware, large chunks of the Lake District and so on. It's only relatively recently, in the last decade, that the Trust has come back to recognising that nature conservation is part of our heritage, and that's greatly to be welcomed. But that was the second flaw in Rothschild's vision. The National Trust simply, as I'll tell you exactly what they said in a minute, wasn't interested. Rothschild and his three colleagues, having established the society, worked very quickly. And by the early months of 1913, they had a preliminary list of sites worthy of preservation. And by 1915, they'd identified 284 sites throughout the British Isles, including Ireland, of course, the Arab, which was part of those days of the British Isles. There were 182 sites in England. Sites worthy of preservation, the sites in the list are sometimes called Rothschild's Reserves. Whatever Aubrey Manning said about the brilliance of the choice, actually it was a bit eclectic, slightly haphazard, but basically brilliant. In Yorkshire, the sites that we still treasure still exist. You'll recognise them: Askham Bog, Flamborough Head, Forge Valley, Grass Wood, Hornsey Mere, Spurn Point. But they regarded Spurn, interestingly, of only of secondary importance. And the Thorn and Hatfield Moors. When you look, that's the map of the sites. There are quite a lot of dots on what was then Yorkshire. Yorkshire's changed its boundaries slightly since then, but so you can see the dots. But when you look at the map and you read the where the places are, I have to confess that of the remainder that in Yorkshire, and there were quite a lot, I have no clue where they are. They no longer exist, basically. They've gone. Or they were badly destroyed, or the remnants of them survived. But the core of the Rothschild sites for Yorkshire we still regard as important, and quite a lot of those, of course, are Yorkshire Wildlife Trust reserves now. throughout England, over the last 100 years, the destruction of the sites identified in the Rothschild reserves is both staggering and profoundly depressing. This book, Rothschild's Reserves, which was published in 1997, it was published by Rothschild's daughter, Miriam Rothschild, who was herself a brilliant entomologist, and by Peter Murren. And they analysed in 1997 what had happened to all those sites. Just over 10% of them were still essentially intact. Just 10%. 84 of them, just about half, still have more than half their habitats intact. But depressingly, A third of them survive, but only as tiny remnants, with more than half of all their habitats destroyed, and 11% of them have been completely destroyed. Just put that in context. Just imagine the cathedrals of England as described and listed, let's say, at the turn of the century. And then imagine what the public outcry would be if only 10% of England's cathedrals that existed 100 years ago still existed. Just imagine what the outcry would be. And if we'd managed to totally destroy 10% of all England's cathedrals. Because that's what we've done to our wildlife sites. Remember, these 100 years ago, these were regarded by Rothschild, who was extremely well informed, as the last relics of unspoilt nature in this country. And we've managed to bugger up half of them. That's the problem. Now, to simplify a very long and complicated story, which is somewhat rose-tinted in the film that you've just seen, it's basically true, but it gives you it's the really favourable end of the spin. Rothschild's hopes that the National Trust would take over the sites, as I said, proved illusory. And in 1918, the National Trust basically washed its hands of all sites of interest only to naturalists. And because of that, the SPNR, despite Rothschild's considerable personal wealth, was unable to move his vision forward hardly at all. There were no reserves created while Rothschild was still alive, and he died in 1932, and without his drive and his money, SPNR achieved essentially nothing between his death and the 1930s. It had a great vision, but it had no means of delivering that vision. And the establishment of new nature reserves didn't happen, and we continued to lose sites at a truly appalling rate. And something had to be done. And part of that something, a really important part of that something, was, amongst others, the birth of the Naturalist Trust movement. As you've been told several times today, the first one, the Clyde Marshes in Norfolk, came on the market and was bought 180 hectares for a princely sum of just over £5,000, which was a lot of money in those days. And it was handed over to a newly formed trust and created the Norfolk Naturalist Trust to hold the marsh in perpetuity as a bird breeding sanctuary. Just birds, never mind about all the other stuff, they'll look after itself, just birds. And now, of course, the Norfolk Naturalist Trust has a much broader vision to conserve all nature. And the very similar thing happened, almost identical thing happened, for the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust. And the SPNR film that you saw, the history of the Trust Conservation Movement, managed to jump from the Norfolk Naturalist Trust as the first trust in the country to the Lincolnshire Naturalist Trust, which is the third trust in the country, and somehow miss out the whole of Yorkshire. It's astonishing. Absolutely astonishing. But first of all, the thing that happened in 1939, remember this is just before the outbreak of the Second World War. In 1939, the fortunes of SPNR changed markedly because it was left a very large legacy by George Druce, and the SPNR suddenly began to waken up as a political force for nature conservation. And the even more remarkable thing is that the wartime government put the concept of... Remember, we were fighting a war by this time with Germany. The national government at that time had the wisdom and the vision to have the concept of national parks, of nature reserves, and the protection of the countryside as a high demand on the political agenda. It has been said to me by historians who understand these things that perhaps national parks and nature reserves and the protection of the countryside was something worth fighting for, and not just in the way that we use the word fighting for. Fighting a serious war. And during that time, which, just think, bombs dropping on London, bombs being all over the British Isles, we were thinking about what was going to happen after the war in terms of nature conservation and national parks. It's truly a remarkable vision for which the politicians involved deserve huge praise. And during that important phase, SPNR, RSPB, the County for the Preservation of Rural England and others were there to help the government in formulate that vision at the height of the war between 1942 and 1943. And in that turmoil, Askham Bog emerged as an important site for us. The timeline is pretty simple. In 1940 to 42, a timber merchant during the war bought part of Askham Bog and tried to fell the trees. If you've ever been to Askham Bog, you'll notice that actually it's not very easy, and it is said that somewhere in Far Wood a tractor disappeared into the peat. Maybe apocryphal, but it says a lot about the nature of the bog, and he failed. Recognising the threat, however, Sir Francis Terry and Arnold Rowntree bought near and far woods in 1944. And you know why. And I'll come back to their association with the site about why they did in a moment or two. But as we heard earlier today, we've got some of their family with us today. And then, just like the Northern Naturalist Trust was formed to accept Cly as a reserve, the Yorkshire Naturalist Trust was founded with the primary aim of accepting Askham Bog as our first reserve, as a gift from Terry and Rowntree. And they did that, incidentally, with the help of the Norfolk Naturalist Trust. Notice SPNR was not involved in any of this at all. SPNR really still hadn't got its act together very well. Fortuitously, the owner of the remainder of Askham, Lysett Green, entered into an agreement with the Trust to manage the other two parts of the bog, and the first keeper of the bog, the honorary secretary of the Trust, was Bernard Lindley. And as a nice sort of symmetry, we continued to manage Gilson's Bog and Middlewood, which we didn't own, but Isaac Green owned, as a part of our reserve, and then we were able to buy those two additional bits at our Golden Jubilee in 1996. Why Terry and Rowntree? Well, both have been pupils at Bootham School. And the boys of Bootham School have a long and distinguished history of recording the natural history of Askham Bog. They started before it was Bootham School, when it was the Quaker School, and as early as 1834, the boys were visiting the bog. This is a wonderful quote by a 14-year-old. It's actually taken from the book on the right-hand side, which is Alastair Fitter's and Clifford Smith's book on the history of Askham Bog. It's now long out of print, but we were able to find a copy today, a second-hand copy, which we've given to David Attenborough as a present for coming. But this is a wonderful quote from that book of a 14-year-old boy from the Quaker School. On Monday morning, about 10 of us, accompanied by J.F., that's John Ford, the headmaster, set off to Askham Bog to try and find some water beetles and perhaps a few plants. He then had some comments about what they found. For example, he was obviously a young man, much older than his years. We found the sweet gale, Myrica gallia, growing in plenty, but there seemed to be no female flowers. At least we found none. And they found beetles and stuff. And then, this is the bit I really like, remember he's 14. After about 2.5 hours, we mustered for dinner. And having procured an addition to our own prog, which was schoolboy slang for food in those days, some bread, cheese, butter and beer made a hearty meal. They knew how to collect insects in those days. And then the early years of the Yorkshire Naturalist Trust were a familiar struggle for money and influence. I love the announcement of the formation of the Trust. The naturalists and lovers of the beauties of Yorkshire will be interested to learn of the formation of the Yorkshire Naturalist Trust Limited, with the primary purpose of establishing and maintaining sanctuaries for the preservation of wildlife, particularly of rare and unusual character. Life membership was a tenner. If you joined then, you'd have made a fortune, wouldn't you? An ordinary membership was not less than 10 shillings. The first public appeal for money was in 1955 to raise money to buy Moorlands, which is our second reserve. And by 1963, we had five reserves, all entirely run by volunteers. By 1970, I came to York in 1971. By 1970, membership passed a staggering number of 2,000. And we had 29 reserves. Incidentally, I joined in 1972, and my membership number is 3,151. And during that journey to when I first came to York, we acquired Spurn, despite what Rothschild said about it, from the War Office in 1959. It was an absolutely inspirational acquisition. You remember, in 1959, we only had 500 members. And yet we took on the purchase of Sperm Point, this huge, fantastic reserve, and it was accomplished by Dr. Edward Wilfred Taylor, who'd taken over as president from the first holder of the office from Terry. And we also bought in 1971, the year I came here, we bought 109 hectares, 270 acres of Weldrake Ings, the first land that was put into nature conservation in the Lower Derwent Valley. And I particularly single out Weldrake Ings and the whole of the Lower Derwent Valley, which is now a National Nature Reserve in its entirety, because not quite as in the same league as David Attenborough, but I've been fortunate to visit all the continents of the world to work and study their biology. This is still my favourite place in the whole world. It is managed, as many of you will know, as hay meadows in the summer, and those hay meadows are called Ings. And modern-day Scandinavian for a wet meadow is Inga. So an ing, which you find all over the Danelaw, are actually Viking meadows, and they're well over 1,000 years old. And they've been managed probably in this traditional way since Viking times, for hay in the summer, and then they flood in the winter, and you shoot wildfowl on them. The whole of the valley gradually became a National Nature Reserve, and you can trace the history of the name changes and the ownership through the signs. So on the left-hand side there is Weldrake Ings, when the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust first bought it, and it was called the Yorkshire Naturalist Trust. We became the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust in 1983. The Nature Conservancy Council, as it then was, began to acquire land in the valley in 1982 and finally pieced together the whole National Nature Reserve by 1991, by which time Nature Conservancy Council had become English Nature, and it changed its name again to Natural England in 2006. I hope you're following all that. And today we have over 40,000 members, we have an annual turnover of over £5 million. We have nearly 100 reserves. Actually, Rob Stoneman says we're just in discussion with a West Riding borough to take over some of their land. Rob says we now have more than 100 reserves, which we sort of borrowed. Is it Barnsley? Barnsley District Council in Barnsley. And we've now got just over 100 reserves. We need 100 members of staff, 86 full-time equivalents, and about 850-900 regular volunteers. It's a completely different kind of organisation. It has to be, because our primary purpose is now much more than establishing and maintaining sanctuaries for the preservation of wildlife of a rare and unusual character. Important as our reserves are and will always be, we do lots of other things now. We do education. Our first paper on education to council was 1974 to the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust. Last year we dealt with over 300 planning applications across the whole of Yorkshire on sites that threatened wildlife sites, not just our own reserves. We do policy advocacy. Last year we engaged with nearly 50 MPs. We give a lot of advice to landowners out with our reserves, as you've heard, because just looking after our own reserves will not deliver effective nature conservation. We need to deliver nature conservation in the wider countryside. And we do a lot of advice to other landowners. We're heavily involved in flood management, because making space for water and preventing people's homes from flooding makes space for nature as well. We have the Stirley Community Farm, again unthinkable when we were first founded, reaching hard to reach groups where getting children and families from deprived areas, often from ethnic groups that it was difficult for us to reach in other ways, growing their own food and making contact with nature that way. Great success. We have our own flying beef herd. Sheep and cattle, they don't actually fly. Pigs fly. But sheep and cattle don't fly, but we move them around the country to help graze our nature reserves and effectively manage our nature reserves. And I have friends who are vegetarian who turn their nose up at Stirley Farm beef, and I say, you're just eating a mowing machine. We're into marine conservation. We do training. We do retail and catering. And we do communication by Twitter and email. We have currently over 16,000 Facebook followers. I'm not one of them. And the Wildlife Trust movement as a whole has still become a very long way since those early days. But even so, SPNR lost its way again in the 1950s. And the Wildlife Trust movement basically made its own way for quite a long time without the help, or sometimes with a very awkward relationship with SPNR. A decade later, in the early 1960s, there were 15 wildlife trusts, which obviously we were one. We met in Skegness, the Skegness Conference. Hasn't quite got the ring of the Paris Conference, has it? It was a landmark conference in which the SPNR began to manage and help coordinate the work of the trusts. Eventually all the naturalist trusts became wildlife trusts. There are now 47 of them. They cover all parts of the UK, and SPNR became the Royal Society for Nature Conservation in 1981 and remains somewhat comfortably from time to time, but the overarching body that helps coordinate the wildlife trust movement. And as an aside, David Attenborough was its president in 1991-95. And we have to do all that. We have to grow. We don't have to grow because growth is a good thing in its own right. We need to grow because the challenges confronting wildlife are many and varied. But I'm going backwards, aren't I? There we go. It's the challenges that we have to meet that are great. So this graph just refers to the 1970s. Agriculture is now unbelievably more intense than it was when Rothschild was alive. Those graphs show the decline of what used to be common farmland birds. Because of the intensification of agriculture, many species on farmland have suffered catastrophic collapses, and agriculture is way more intensive than it ever was in Rothschild's day. Not just farmland birds. In the report on the state of nature in 1913, David Attenborough said this important document provides a stark warning. Far more species are declining than increasing in the UK, and many of our most treasured species are disappearing. But think, that doesn't mean to say the Wildlife Trust movement has failed or the RSPB has failed. Just think how much worse it would be if we hadn't been here. 80% of all our lowland heaths have been lost, most since 1950. 97% of our species-rich grasslands have been lost since the Second World War. In the mid-1930s, there was a tuna fishing industry in the North Sea. There were that many fish in the North Sea. Not anymore. And so on and so forth. So we have to get bigger, we have to grow, we have to have more members for more political clout, more money, more influence, to do all the things we now need to do to make space for nature. And we can and we will do that. We will reverse those dreadful losses, and the first signs, the first progress, the first visions are already there. So let me hand over to Rob Stoneman to tell you what the good news is. Because you're part of something new, exciting, getting bigger for the benefits of people and wildlife. Thank you very much. Rob.
Well, thank you very much, John. John's really set the context for the modern Yorkshire Wildlife Trust that we see today. And what I want to talk about today is really a simple narrative, really, that nature really does matter. And in that nature matters so much is the seeds of our future success. Just to reiterate, and a little bit of science, Sir John Lawton and his co-authors wrote a massively influential report that we all call the Lawton Review, which set out this basic concept that's really fundamental to nature conservation, and it's this. If you have fantastic sites that are isolated, and this is Rothschild's original Wood Walton Fen, it was saved for the large copper butterfly. The large copper butterfly went extinct on that site many, many years ago, and you can see why. Because if, for whatever reason, a species is lost, like large copper, there is no ability to come back. And if we have those local extinctions turning into regional extinctions, we go the way of the dodo. In some parts of the UK, and hey, Yorkshire's definitely one of them, we still have connected landscapes. And it's where we have that connections, we have much, much more resilient nature. So living landscapes, this concept of building an ecological network, is fundamental, particularly in an era of rapid climate change. Just to give you an example of that, Here's, again, coming out of the Lawton Review, a nature improvement area here on the Humberhead Levels, just near between from North Cave down to Doncaster, down into the North Nottinghamshire coalfields. And here we're trying to map out, well, what would a living landscape actually look like? A largely wetland living landscape in that case. And there are nodes within that living landscape. And, you know, a beautiful, beautiful site. Potterick Carr is a classic. Imagine if you could get a site, recreate part of that fenland system that stretched from Cambridge all the way to York. Imagine if you could get a site big enough to get back some of those iconic fenland species that have been long lost for hundreds of years from lowland Yorkshire. Species like black-necked grebe or bittern or marsh harrier. Imagine if you had marsh harrier breeding just outside Doncaster. It seemed inconceivable, and yet 2 years ago we had our first breeding marsh harrier back on the levels of Doncaster after an absence of probably 300 or 400 years, because Potterick Carr is now big enough to sustain those fantastic species. Out at sea, of course, we have exactly the same sorts of issues, perhaps writ large, and some of the losses out at sea are remarkable. 90% of our predatory fish, the stuff that we eat, the cod, the haddock, the plaice, have been lost since the 1900s. The southern North Sea basin, stretching from Flamborough all the way down to the Thames estuary, was a breeding ground for the flat oyster, abundant in Neolithic times, abundant through medieval times, and now an extremely rare species. Yet in that interconnected world, that 3D world of the sea, if we can get nature conservation right, essentially a network of marine protected areas and effective licensing for sustainable development at sea, we can see the recovery of wildlife could be even quicker on land. In fact, we're talking about the recovery of wildlife happening within a generation, 25 years. Wouldn't that be amazing if us as the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust or the Wildlife Trust could engender that sort of recovery at that sort of speed? And so that leads to our mission, our vision, our purpose. And I just want to go through some of these words. Every organisation has these sort of things, but it kind of really matters if we're in the Wildlife Trust. So our vision for wildlife is a Yorkshire rich in wildlife for everyone. It's not just about the naturalists, the birders, the specialists. It's for every single person to enjoy wildlife across this wonderful county of ours, whether they're deep inside the urban areas, as most of Yorkshire people are, or out in the country villages. It's for everyone, and that's a fundamental point. Our purpose is to reverse the decline, and that's actually quite tricky. You know, we are up against some serious headwinds of intensive agriculture, of eutrophication, i.e. nitrogen enrichment of the countryside, which turns our flowery road verges, for example, into nettle beds. And we have huge amounts of nitrogen coming out of agriculture again, but also out of the exhausts of the cars that we all drive. We have the pressures of unsustainable development. When we talk about climate change and the impact on species, we've already seen that movement north of species, and we know that in 50 years' time, the species that you would find now in northern France or southeast England are going to be the sorts of species we see here in Yorkshire just 50 years' time, if they can get across London, if they can get across HS2. So we have to get development right. HS2 could be, for example, not only a quick way to London, do we really need it? But if we built it in the right way, it could be the ecological superhighway for those species moving north thing. If we built it in the wrong way, it's quite obviously a massive barrier. And above all else, the challenge of climate change. We live in extraordinary times. The globe is warming faster than it has done for billions of years, probably never warmed as fast as it is at the moment. So, you know, we have an enormous challenge upon our hands. And for the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust, these values around there are really important. We need not just to bang on about it, we're very good at that, we need to lead, we need to demonstrate, and that's why our nature reserves are so important, that we can demonstrate what needs to be done. And we need to take a stand. We need to say, let's not build a barrier to wildlife through HS2, let's build it in the right way. We can't do that on our own, so we need to do that in a very grand partnership. And everything that the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust is a partnership between you as supporters, between the people who own and manage the land, between society as a whole. We need to keep advocating our vision, because it's a strong vision, and we need to advocate that to wider society, And we need to inspire people, because if you don't love wildlife, if you don't have that passion in the hearts that all of you guys have got, you're never going to care and you're never going to take action. So that inspiration, that education, bringing the younger generation in is so fundamental. And above all else, and hey, this is so Wildlife Trust, we need to actually do something. We need to get out there and make nature conservation a reality. And it's ditch by ditch, field by field, forest by forest, it's actually making a difference on the ground. And so some of the other concepts that come out of our mission for living landscapes and living seas is taking people on a journey with us. Ultimately, any charity who are for public benefit want to put themselves out of existence. We would like to see wildlife to be part of the weft and weave of this great county of ours, of this nation of ours. And ultimately, we wouldn't need to be here. I have to say, we're probably not going to disappear anytime soon. So it's important that we take people up a ladder of involvement that eventually empowers people to make a difference themselves. So that can be anything from the inspiration of visitors on our reserves, our fantastic magazine, the web pages we do, all the school children that go through our gateway sites, running all those events, all those volunteers that get involved, a massively important part of how we get people involved in nature conservation, advocating to politicians, working with people, community development, green space development, and so on. These are all fundamental to taking people on that ladder of involvement. And we need to do things locally, and it's a challenge actually. Yorkshire's a pretty big place. You know, when I started 10 years ago, we had 35 staff, 30 of them were based here in York. Today, we have 110 staff, and we still have about 30 based in York, which means most of our staff are out there in the regions, and we want to work from gateway sites, literally a gateway to nature conservation, the places where we can genuinely inspire people and get people involved in nature conservation. So places like Stirley Community Farm on the edge of Huddersfield, fabulous farmland landscape, demonstrating how we can change the way that the Pennine Fringe is managed to really recognise the richness of that landscape. Places like Spurn, Spurn Point, in between the sumptuous Humber estuary, that the yin and yang of the Arctic ecosystem to the north, so all of that fantastic wildlife in that amazing wilderness, one of the last untouched wildernesses on the planet, of course in those dark and freezing winter months have to move somewhere, and they come to our British estuaries. So to have that on one side and then the North Sea on the other side, what a fantastic place to inspire and educate people about the wonderful wildlife of Yorkshire. The Living Sea Centre, our foray into marine. Tell people about the North Sea. Many people think the North Sea is freezing and polluted, and yet it's still got amazing wildlife. It still has porpoises and big cod and fantastic sea creatures in there. We need to tell people about that, and we do that in the Living Sea Centre. And I've talked about it before, but the amazing Potter Carr Nature Reserve on the edge of Doncaster, our first gateway site. So these are incredibly important sites. We really could do with maybe 12 gateway sites, 4 for now, but we're on our way. And of course, we need to be a thriving organisation. If people give us money, and thank you everybody who does give us money here, we need to ensure that that money is well spent. So we need to be thriving, and you know, that membership growth is a really important part of that. It's not just about money, and you know, if we ask our members, why do they join the Wildlife Trust? Many of them are honest enough to say, actually, I just want to give you money so that you can get on with nature conservation. But 40,000 members is a massive political force for nature conservation, and that matters. It really does matter. We need an efficient back office. In the end, nature conservation relies on having the right people in the right place with the right data, using the right equipment at the right time, making a difference on the ground. And of course that costs money, and we need to do that in an efficient and effective way. So our regional approach, what we try to do is to take priority living landscapes and look at how we can integrate a set of activities so that we can actually start to make a difference, so that the sum of our parts becomes greater than the individual bits. So for example, in South Yorkshire, we've been working on the Magnesium Limestone Bridge, that glorious sweep of flower-rich meadows that stretches from North Nottinghamshire right up into Durham. But of course, it's highly fragmented by agriculture, as you might expect. But even so, on that ridge are still fantastic flower-rich meadows and fantastic limestone woodlands. And so from the Potterick Carr Gateway site, we are undertaking magnesium limestone flower restoration at places like our own nature reserves at Maltby Low Common or Sproutborough Flash. We have a limestone, a magnesium limestone project, bringing land into conservation management, often about grazing animals. We have a highways project where we're working with Highways Agency and Network Rail and looking how we can improve those potential ecological corridors and so on. That's just one example. I could also talk about the work that we're doing in the North Doncaster levels or in the Dearne Valley. In West Yorkshire, again, a whole range of different activities going on, but I'll just talk about one of those projects, the Upper Aire Valley Water Framework Directive Water Quality Project. And essentially what we're trying to do there is to improve water quality by slowing the flow, so that instead of those nutrients coming into the water systems and flying down and polluting the whole water system, we allow natural processes to take those high nutrient levels out. And we do a whole range of different interventions, whether that be tree planting or leaky dams is a good example here. And of course, these sorts of concepts, slowing the flow, are fundamental in terms of reducing flooding in places like Leeds. And when we look at the Boxing Day floods in Leeds, another £300 million insurance payout, on top of the £1 billion insurance payout in 2007 from the June 2007 floods, you can see that these are fundamental concepts to get right. Let's move into the seas. Again, another wave, another pile of different projects, but I'll talk about one of those, the Waves of Waste project. And this is simple in its in concept, more complicated in execution. But here we're trying to work with local fishermen to reduce marine litter. There's an awful lot of litter and waste in our seas, and the local fishermen are trawling this stuff up all the time. And previously, because they didn't have anywhere to put this stuff, they generally chucked it back in again. And what we've now done is provided bins, we've provided a mechanism for inshore fishermen to move that waste out. That's a fairly straightforward project. Much, much more importantly than that is that we're engaging with a whole set of inshore fishermen who obviously we can then start talking to them about improving the sustainability of fishing techniques so that we don't overfish the North Sea, that we allow fishing to continue and we get those thriving fishing communities back on the basis of increasing wildlife, not decreasing wildlife. That's got to be good for everybody. Another set, East Yorkshire. Let's move into the east here. Fabulous picture of our newly restored lighthouse at Sperm Point here. But I'll talk about just one of those projects again, a nature tourism project. This is our first entirely economic project. And again, the concept is simple. If we look at the nature tourism economy of East Yorkshire, it's approximately 10 to 15 million pounds per annum. Pretty substantial stuff. But if you go to North Norfolk, the place where those first nature reserves were, and you look at that muddy estuary, that sandy shore, those very low chalk hills behind, have a £60 million nature tourism economy. House prices are double what they are in East Yorkshire, in Holderness. Let's look at East Yorkshire with its muddy estuary, its sandy shore, and much, much more impressive chalk hills behind it. Why is it that they have such a buoyant nature economy and we don't? Simply because they had the first nature reserves. It's nature reserves and that ability for people to go to the North Norfolk coast and see this incredible wildlife that is driving that enormous economy. We need to have that in East Yorkshire. It's one of our most disadvantaged parts of Yorkshire. And with places like Sperm Point, North Cave Wetlands, Benson Cliffs, Flamborough Cliffs, the Living Sea Centre, the fantastic River Hole, the fantastic Wolds, we know that with just modest investment, just a few millions of pounds, we can generate a tourist income of at least £30 million per annum, and there's no reason that we could go above and beyond the North Norfolk £60 million. So already, after 3 years of work, we've moved that nature tourism economy from £9 million to £15 million a year. We're genuinely mainstreaming nature conservation into the psyche of the economy of East Yorkshire. And into the north, again, an enormous array of activity going on from places like Appleton Mill Farm, superb, beautiful site in the North York Moors, from over into the Dales. And again, I'll just pick one particular project that we've just started, the Plantation Over Ancient Woodlands project. And here we know that many of our woodlands were mistakenly turned into conifer plantations, so that ancient woodland, that fantastic fauna, was ripped out, flora was ripped out, the trees taken down, replanted with conifers on a The idea is that we would become self-sufficient in wood. It never happened. But because that seed bank is still available, if we take that out in a very careful way, those ancient woodlands can come back. We can restore those ancient woodlands that have been there for probably thousands of years. We can restore them to their former glory. And relatively quickly, we're talking about a few decades. We know there are 3,000 hectares of these pause woodlands or plantation over ancient woodlands on the southern slope, on the tabular limestone, southern slope of the North York Moors alone. So we've started at Appleton Mill Farm to start that restoration of those woodlands, a very complicated project around providing a wood fuel market, working with the private sector, particularly small woodland owners. It's complicated stuff. Look, I can't stand up here and for one moment begin to cover the whole range of the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust work. Many pictures can, so I'll sit down for 2 seconds. It's always a bright, sunshiny day in Yorkshire, isn't it? Actually, it's not always. But we're always smiling about it. Well, that's 1 year's work. 1 year's work of the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust. It's breathtaking what we get up to. It's extraordinary. And, huge thanks to the staff team and particularly the volunteer team. You know, 850 volunteers. That's an enormous force for nature conservation. So a particular thanks to them for the amount of work that they do. But of course, it's no time to relax. Another 70 years beckons of the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust, and we need to look at where we're at and where we want to be. And we want to continue our ambition. So what do we want to see? We want to see our uplands. You know, those drained, burnt and overgrazed uplands, we want to see them restored. We want to see all of our peat bogs restored. all of them supporting a sphagnum carpet and the fantastic wildlife out. Those unique upland heaths that have to be burnt, by the way. We should have them back in good condition. 98% of our upland flower-rich meadows have gone, even within the national parks. We need to reverse the trend. And surely we need to rewild some of those uplands and bring back some of the iconic species that are now lost from the Dales uplands and the Yorkshire uplands, for example, hen harrier. Our rivers. We've done a huge amount of work on our rivers, but we need to continue to eradicate the pollution that brought some of the Yorkshire rivers to absolute death, biological death. And we've come way back from that. Many of our rivers are now supporting salmon and trout, and we need to ensure that those migratory fish can get up to the very tops of our river system and take out all of those obstructions. We need to reconnect our rivers to the floodplains, not least to protect our towns and cities from flooding. And we need to ensure that the invasives that so blight our riversides, the giant hogweed, the Japanese knotweed and so on, need to be removed, and our urban rivers taken back out of their culverts so they become part of the weft and weave of our city centres. In the lowlands, we need to have an agricultural system that sustains rather than destroys wildlife. Of course we need to produce food, but as our farms show and RSPB farms show, we can design an agricultural system that allows wildlife to thrive and grows food and is profitable. We need to be providing land on the edge of local cities that provide high quality local food for a local population. So at Stirley Farm, picture in the background, we've shown how we can produce beef, how we can produce vegetables on the edge of the city and allow the local population to get involved in that food production and eat the food, of course. That should be the norm, not the exception. And obviously we're paving the way there. Our cities should be green, far, far greener than they are. We need our cities to be essentially afforested so that they're woodland cities of accessible natural green spaces threading through the whole of our urban areas, because we know that's massively important for our quality of life and for our urban wildlife. And could we get back some of those iconic species that we're talking about in our fenlands? Again, as the arable soils of the fenland degrade, and that's a reality that's going on, can we restore part of that lost fenland landscape, working in and around water rather than against water, and seeing once more these abundant, what were once abundant birds like crane and bittern restored to the Yorkshire fenland scene? I think we can. The Humber, the fantastic Humber estuary. It has to remain as a highway for shipping. It's been redefined as the energy estuary as we move towards renewable energy. Absolutely right, because that's part of a sustainable future. But all of that can be done to sustain our wildlife rather than destroy it. It's not about balancing off jobs and birds. That's ridiculous. It's about creating jobs through birds and allowing birds and all the other wildlife of the Humber to increase. We need to have a rewilded coastal hinterland sustaining a vibrant ecotourism economy around the Humber to add to that renewable energy and more sustainable developments. The North Sea was once one of the most productive seas on the planet. If we look at Callum Roberts' book, for example, he's a professor here at the University of York, he talks about shoals of porpoises in the Humber estuary that were so abundant they blocked shipping. He talked about shoals of cod that were so huge that you could go out in small boats and pick cod out of the water with buckets. We can get that sort of abundance back in the North Sea if we do the right thing. And of course that will be central to our revitalised fishing communities, to ecotourism and to bring back prosperity to the coast. So the question is this just a pipe dream? Is the next 70 years going to be characterised in the way of the last 70 years, where really all we're trying to do is hang on to the last vestiges of a once rich, wildlife-rich Yorkshire? Well, I don't think it is. I don't think it is because nature really, really does matter. When we look at some of the most serious issues that face society today, let's consider some of those diseases of the modern world, obesity, of diabetes, of the fact that now there's a greater number of people leaving and not being at work because of the stress, of the fact that one in four of us will experience mental health problems at some point in our life, of heart disease, of Alzheimer's. All of those health issues can be partly resolved through quality green spaces, high quality green spaces, all helped by the enjoyment of green space. So fundamentally, nature conservation can start to address things. Nature makes you happy, and there's an abundant amount of science to support that statement. If we look at that housing need, we need an enormous number of housings to pick up on the housing deficit that's come over the last few decades. There is a massive need for housing, we can't get around that. But we mustn't make some of those mistakes that we made in the immediate post-war period of creating soulless housing estates that create the problems of the future. Housing can be green. Here's a great example being taken forward by the Bedfordshire, Cambridgeshire, Northamptonshire Trust at Camborne, where they've surrounded a whole new town in a green space wrapping around that thing. And of course that means a better quality of life, a healthier life for the people living Camborne. Not only that, it sustains property prices and makes us all much, much healthier. So again, nature conservation sits at the very heart of a modern housing policy. Diesel fumes are killing us. 40,000 premature deaths every year as a result of air pollution, mostly in our urban areas. And we need to do a lot. We need to move to electric-powered cars. We need to have congestion zones increase. We need to move to public transport and so on. But do you know there's a much simpler solution? Plant trees in the cities. Make those cities full of trees, because trees absorb that particulate pollution in their leaves and washes harmlessly to the ground and then taken away through wastewater on the ground. In fact, in a green space rich landscape would even sort that particulate solution in the water. And you know what else trees do? They resolve the urban heat island effect, which will become extreme as climate change takes hold. They reduce the amount of noise. They make cities more pleasant. They increase your house prices. They prevent floods. We should be planting way more trees in our city, a simple solution to massive air pollution. And so relevant in Yorkshire. Here in York, we had devastating floods again on Boxing Day. Just before Christmas, rather, and much worse in places like Calderdale and in Leeds. And we've got a choice as a society. We can carry on storing our floodwaters in people's homes, in people's offices, in people's businesses. It's extremely expensive. I mentioned it before. In Yorkshire, from the June 2007 floods, we spent £1.2 billion on that insurance payout. £1.2 billion. That is crazy. And we must find better ways of storing that floodwater. So here's a simple choice. Shall we store floodwater in people's homes and ruin their lives? Or shall we store water in, for example, our nature reserves? And you know, Potterick Carr Nature Reserve on the edge of Doncaster isn't just a fantastic place where you can see bittern. Not that I've ever seen one there. That's another matter. It's also a designed flood storage system. So if we look at those June 2007 floods that devastated North Doncaster, it didn't devastate South Doncaster because we'd stored those storm waters in our nature reserve. Our nature reserve shut for 2 weeks at no particular cost to us, not that anybody paid us for it. But what a fantastic use of nature reserves. Why don't we have things like that all around our cities? Much, much more sensible way forward. Again, nature conservation at the very heart of the problems of our society. And above all else, the great, great, massive challenge of climate change, this horrendous warming of the atmosphere, which will cause great damage across the world, not least the loss of the great breadbasket parts of the world, like the North American plains and Central Asia and so on. So we absolutely have to reduce our emissions to the atmosphere. No question of that. We must go net carbon zero by 2050 and so on. But eventually, you know, we have to take that carbon dioxide back out of the atmosphere and put it away safely. And we nearly spent £1 billion on carbon capture and storage systems from here in Yorkshire at Drax. But, you know, we have a natural carbon capture and storage system that's been working for the last 10,000 years and certainly the last 5,000 years, just up there, not far from here, a little bit down the road, down near Doncaster again, in Thorn and Hatfield Moors, and more particularly up on the Dales and North York Moor uplands in our peat bogs. And that carbon capture and storage system has been doing that job pretty much for free. It doesn't cost us much to make sure that that carbon capture and storage system is effective. And if we look at it at a global scale, on just 3% of the land surface, we store as much carbon in our peat bogs as we do in all of the world's forests. Well, twice as much carbon in our peat bogs as we do in all of the world's forests, which cover about a fifth of the land surface. It's an intensely dense store of carbon. And yet we've so damaged those peatlands across the world that they're now emitting carbon rather than taking carbon out of the atmosphere, such that 8% of all of the world's anthropogenic carbon emissions come from damaged peatlands. And that's a terrible thing, but fixing peatlands is pretty easy. Well, the peat team wouldn't say that. But essentially, it's about damming up those ditches. It's about revegetating those peatlands with the right sort of thing. And, you know, here in Yorkshire, this Yorkshire Wildlife Trust, working with, of course, its partners through the Yorkshire Peat Partnership, has taken, of the 40,000 or the 50,000 or so hectares of damaged peatland, has already brought 27,000 hectares of peatland into conservation management. You know, if we can begin to bring about the restoration of Yorkshire's peatlands and work with all of our partners across the UK so that the UK restores all of its peatlands, we become an exemplar to the global community, and we begin to make climate change, which seems so intractable, an utterly tractable problem by mitigating for 8% of those anthropogenic carbon emissions. We really can make nature conservation central to our society. So we can see the reverse of Yorkshire's wildlife decline, because we can ensure that wildlife becomes central to people's lives. So I genuinely think that the restoration of wildlife isn't impossible. Over the last 70 years, we've gradually moved wildlife conservation from essentially a hobby of naturalists and birders and so on into the very heart of the mainstream of British society. Nature matters emphatically so. So we need to make the case. We need to keep leading the way. And I say to you, bring on the next 70 years as we move from attempting to reduce wildlife decline to restoring nature into the very centre of our lives. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rob Stoneman, our very inspirational Chief Executive, as I'm sure you'll all agree. And thanks to our President, Sir John Lawton, who spoke before. We're at the end of our evening, folks. I hope you've enjoyed it. Before you all dash for the exits, I've just got a few key people I'd really like to thank. Firstly, Vice-Chancellor Professor Cohen Lamberts and his team here at the University of York, who've hosted such a great event for us on this memorable occasion. Thank you to him and his team. A particular note. Joe Hilton Scott, who's been kind of my double from the university, she's pulled out all the stops to make this really successful and has supported the YWT staff team, who've never done anything quite on this scale before. So thanks to Joe. Also from the university, the fantastic AV team. At Yorkshire Wildlife Trust, we have an in-joke, so we can never pull off AV, but they've done a great job tonight. So Steve Parker, Steve Foster, thanks very much. And because we've not done anything like this before, we've never thought to have something beautiful like this along the edge of the stage until we were offered, and Gordon Easton from the university's done all this literally today, so great stuff, Gordon. Now, can you put your hands up if you've not yet bought one of these? These are going to be worth a fortune on eBay. Now, Northwold Print, who also produce our wonderful Wildlife Yorkshire magazine, have printed this for free, so thanks, Northwold Print. So don't forget to get your copy on the way out if you haven't yet bought one. I'm sure you will all be entering the prize draw. I mentioned we've got some great prizes. I'm just quickly going to run through the list here because I know you all want to get home. But they all deserve my thanks and Yorkshire Wildlife Trust's thanks. So first of all, two artists, some celebrated Yorkshire artists, have donated some original artwork. So we have Robert Fuller and Sheila Berry. Forest Holidays have given a very good prize as well. We've had Betty's, Langlands, Nigel Brown, Wold Top Brewery, I'm hoping I win that one, and last but not least, Acorn Glade Glamping. So thanks to all of those people. Thank you once again to all of our guests, speakers this evening, Alastair Fitter, John Lawton, Rob Stoneman, and of course Sir David Attenborough. Who I'm hoping is now somewhere round about Newark on the train on his way back to London. And my last thanks really go to all of my team at the Trust who've really, well, volunteered their time to help with this event. I can't do it without them, or the Trust can't do it without them, so big thanks to them. I'm going to let them all go in a moment so they can all help you on the way out as well, so bear with me a second. But just a few key people from that team who've really pulled out all the stops to make this event really successful. Firstly, Jessica Thompson, Sally Henderson, Eden Jackson, Sandra Pohl, Julie Smith and Tom Marshall. So if you could give it up for those guys. So if I could ask our volunteers to man the doors before you all dash, that would be great. And really, there's only one set of people to thank, really, and that is you guys. You know, Yorkshire Wildlife Trust wouldn't be here after 70 years if it wasn't for you guys who are our members, our volunteers, our funders, our supporters, our trustees, etc. So thank you. Here's, as Rob said just now, to the next 70 years, and good night.